Good morning, Cross Hill Church. We love you. Do you know that all things are possible with our Lord? Come on, let's sing it.
Almighty God, my Redeemer, my hiding place, my safe refuge, no other name like Jesus, no power can stand against you. My feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you, and I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. Almighty God, my Redeemer, my hiding place, my safe refuge, no other name like Jesus, no power can stand against you. My feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on.
Is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. Come on, he's alive. And oh, happy day. Happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. And I'm standing in that place, free at last. meeting face to face. I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive.
Yeah, come on.
He's alive. And
oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. And oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
Oh, what a glorious way. What a glorious way that you have saved me. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious day. Oh. Oh. Happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
What a wonderful name it is, the name of
my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not harm you. The veil torn before you. You silenced the post of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. And you have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Welcome to church, to Cross Hill Church. Thank you. We worship the Lord. We thank you for being with us today. We thank you for being a part of our service. We're happy that you're joined with us. And we have the Word of God coming in a very powerful way. We thank you for your time. And I was thinking today, I heard a report. And this report was not good. You know, we're hearing a lot of statistics these days. And the report was not good. It was about people that were giving up. It comes right down to the point they didn't have any hope. Finances, jobs, family, everything that is out there is a bad report. And there was no hope. And this report said that those people had given up. And the numbers seemed to be climbing. But our hope is in God Almighty, yes, Jesus Lord, our Lord and Savior. He is our hope. He will never give up on us. Hallelujah. And when it looks like there is no hope, he's just getting started. So what we're going to do today is we're presenting the word for you. So if there's anyone there that needs an answer, Christ is the answer. But that hope is coming from the word of God. And we are so glad that you're with us today.
Amen.
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 We're glad you're with us. We come to that time in our service that we are going to take an offering. That we have several different ways that we give through our church. One of them you can give online giving, www.chnorco.com. Give, click on the give link, and there is several different places you can choose there through Easy Tithe, but there are several places that you can put your money to the general church. You can put it to what the Reach Project that helps us with what we're doing electronically. There's Give to Text, 909-325-3114. Cross Hill Church, if you choose to mail in your tithe, and we're having people do that, P.O. Box 11448, San Bernardino, California, 92423. So as you give, so that you know, the whatever you give is going to go to the furtherance of the kingdom. And God is a blessing God. God knows our hearts. And God knows, He knows what you have.
Hallelujah.
He knows what you need. He knows what this church needs. And He is Almighty God. He prepares hearts.
Yes.
So right now we're asking that He prepare your heart. We thank you, Father. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for blessing gift and giver. And Lord, cause the word that goes forth today to do the work you planned. Bless your messenger as he brings the message. And Lord, bless the ears. And Lord, in our homes, may those interruptions not happen so we can hear clearly
yes.
the word of God.
Yes.
And we thank you for every ear. Bless every ear that hears. Bless every home that is touched. Every life that is touched. And we will give you praise and honor and glory. And all of God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Bless his name. Hallelujah. Bless his name. This morning as I was in prayer, I was in our backyard. It was a beautiful morning. And I was sitting there and I was praying. And I was just looking at God's beauty. You know, we can look at the bad, the desert places, or we can look at the good. Amen?
Yes.
And as I was sitting there praying, thinking about you, I began to see these little lizards all across my wall. In fact, Doug thinks we're a lizard factory, I believe, because we have so many lizards in our backyard. And I saw these little lizards going across the wall, not a care in the world. Just running back and forth, chasing each other, running around, up and down the wall. Bees flying around. And this is the Lord reminded me of the scripture, and I turned to it. Luke 12:22, it says, then Jesus said, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life. See, I was praying for you. I wasn't worried. I knew where to go. But he says to cast our care on him, amen? What you will eat or what your body will wear, for life is more than food and your body more than clothes. Consider the ravens, those little birds I saw flying. They do not sow or reap. They have no storeroom or barn, yet God feeds them. God was feeding those lizards. I began to think about those little lizards. He cares for them. Honey, do you not know that He cares even more for you?
Amen.
The flowers aren't wondering where they're going to get a drink.
Right.
They've got me, for one. Give them a drink with the hose, but the dew, it's there in the morning, and we've got to realize who our God is. He says, don't worry. I'm not telling you. He's telling you. It must be possible, otherwise He wouldn't say it. Do not worry. Consider how the wildflowers grow, that you don't labor or spin, yet I tell you, not even Solomon, all of his splendor, was dressed like one of them. Your Heavenly Father cares for you. He loves you. He hasn't forgotten you.
Right.
He knows what you have need of, even before you ask. And so I want you, as an act of faith, to stand if you aren't already. We're going to bring our needs before our Father. You know, even in the middle of a crisis, God has a plan for His church. Do you understand me?
Amen.
Even in the middle of a global pandemic, God has a plan for His church. Do I get a witness? We have to still walk in His power. We still got to
live in his goodness. We gotta dig in our heels to what his word says, and that's what we're gonna do right now. Father God, we come to you in the glorious name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that you care, you love us, you want the best for us, your children. And I thank you, Father God, that in spite of what the enemy is trying to do and doing to some, you promised us, Lord God, that you have our back if we just lean into you and trust you. Lean into you and do what is right. Lean into your word. Get in deeper into your word. So, Father, we trust you that you own the cattle on a thousand hills and you'll surely take care of us. You clothe the flowers. You clothe the lilies of the field. You will take care of us. I thank you, Father God, that you know the needs of your children. Those who are in need of jobs, Father God, in the name of Jesus, I trust you, Lord, that even when the enemy would say there are no jobs and people are losing businesses and businesses are failing, that no, your children rise up. They rise up. We're blessed. I thank you, Lord God, that you are creating jobs. If it's just for your children, you're creating jobs. And an open heaven is theirs. I thank you, Father God, that in spite of what the pandemic says, they're getting promotion. Promotion comes from you, and we receive it in Jesus' name. We're not going under, we're going over. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord God, that we're better than we've ever been. And 2020 will be our even better than what the enemy is trying to tell us otherwise. I thank you, Lord God, you are our healer. You are our deliverer, Father, in the name of Jesus. No weapon formed against us will ever prosper. I thank you, Father, that you're touching lives, those who are addicted and are running to things that they should not. Father, I ask that they run to you and that you will break that addiction right now in Jesus' name. Set them free, I pray. I thank you, Lord, for healing diabetes and heart disease and low... anything the enemy would try to place on your people, we call it whole in Jesus' name. We honor you, Daddy. We love you. We pray for our land. We pray for our government. We pray for our nation. We pray for the world. May we be a light for you, I pray. This week, sir, may we be a light for you, I pray. Show us who we need to talk to. Reveal to us who we need to call and reach out to. And may we be a great witness for you, that no one that we know will not hear the word of God from our lips, that they will find you as the Lord and the Savior, the deliverer of their lives. We give you these things in praise in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. We love you. Let's sing, shall we?
Oh,
the greatness of His mercy and love at the feet of Jesus.
Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
the faithfulness was still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet.
Church, come on, right where you're at, let's give the Lord a shout of praise. What he did before, he'll do it again. Yeah. How many of you need God to do something again for you? Amen. Praise God. It is so good to have you guys just, man, I tell you, we are so close. I'm telling you, we are so close to gathering together. In fact, we have actually, and you can't see it, but we've actually arranged our sanctuary with seats that are acceptably spread apart. but boy, just to have your faces, and we're hearing, listen, every day we're hearing updates, and we just heard a major announcement this week, just a couple of days ago, which tells us that we're really close to meeting together, and we're going to make that announcement really soon. So we just be listening for that and be thinking about how you can get the news. And there's a couple ways you can do it. Listen, go on crosshillchurch.com and just download there's instructions right on the homepage. Download the church app, the Cross Hill app, and you can get push notifications for special things and announcements that we got coming up here, and right on your smartphone, your iPhone or one of those lesser smartphones, which is not the Apple iPhone. But anyway, nothing like that. But anyway, so you can get those downloads, and you can watch services like this service that you're watching right now. You can actually be watching it live on your on that well, the Bible app right there. Anyway, so be listening for that, watch. Hey, listen, we also, I tell you, this is Memorial Weekend. And so at Cross Hill Church, we want to just pause for a moment and just honor the brave men and women who have paid the ultimate sacrifice. We honor our veterans on Veterans Day, and we celebrate our freedoms on 4th of July, Independence Day. But this is the weekend we honor those who have literally paid the ultimate sacrifice. The Bible talks about there is no greater love than a friend lay down his life for a brother. So let's just pause for a moment. Let's go to the Lord, and let's pray for those, especially this generation of people who've the families who sacrificed and that loved one, that son, that daughter, that daddy, that mama is not coming home this year because she paid the ultimate price with her life for our freedoms. So Father, I just pray right now for the families, those who may be in a season of grieving right now. And Father, I ask that you just take your big arms and just love them and lift them up and let them know that they are loved by a nation and they are loved by their God who created them. And Father, we just ask for your mercy and your grace to give them sustainability and strength in this season of mourning. And I pray, Father, as we gather together this weekend, that it won't just be about hot dogs and hamburgers, but it'll be about remembering the great sacrifice that so many lives gave so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we enjoy today. And so we honor them today, Father, in Jesus' name. And we honor you for placing it into the hearts of brave men and women to make that ultimate sacrifice. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, God bless you today. If you have your Bibles with me, will you turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 8. Nehemiah, the 8th chapter. We're in a little mini-series, and we started last weekend in a little series that we're just calling Joy in the Journey. And so this is part two of that, there's a couple little stories I'm going to share with you, some personal things, and we'll try to lighten it up a little bit. It got kind of heavy, it felt like, last week, and so I was watching that play back online, and I thought, boy, I sure got kind of heavy in there. So we're gonna kind of have a little bit different perspective on it, and the same out of the same passage of Scripture. Now, I'm reading from Nehemiah, the 8th chapter, beginning in verse number 5. But before we go there, let me set this up for you. Once again, if you'll remember, at the time of this writing, the people of Jerusalem, who had been in exile for all those years, many of those who had survived the exile have now come back to their homeland in Jerusalem. So many years before, the city was burned with fire, the walls of the city were destroyed and burned, the temple was destroyed, burned down. Much of the infrastructure of Jerusalem had been destroyed by the surrounding enemies. The precious people of God had been taken away into captivity, into exile, into Babylon. And now it is years later, and now those survivors are now back in their homeland. And by the time we get to Nehemiah, the temple of God had already been reconstructed. It's back up thanks to the leadership of Ezra. And so now there's still a disconnect. There's still a void because they're unfortified. The walls of the city are still down. It's very dangerous. You can't move about because it's not fortified. The people are kind of sheltered in place. They're kind of locked in their homes, and the economy is in absolute turmoil. You go through the first few chapters in Nehemiah, and you see an economy that is in shambles, in turmoils. People are losing their homes, they're losing their jobs, they're furloughed from their businesses. They're in financial distress. They're unable to go out and have the freedoms that they used to enjoy. Does it sound familiar, anybody? sound familiar? And so here we are, and Nehemiah goes to the king, this Persian king, and he gets access, and he's granted permission to go back to his homeland into Jerusalem and help become a leader and build back those walls of Jerusalem. And so he does that, and remarkably, with great leadership, with the help of God, they build that thing back, and in 52 days, it's back up. And after 142 years after its destruction, Jerusalem is now once again a fortified city. And so here we are, in Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 5, and Ezra opened the book, and all the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened the book, the people all stood up. So he opened the book, and I tell you what, you can't see it, but our team here, they're quick on the uptick here today. So as he opened the book, it says that the people stood up, and Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded. So let's lift our hands and respond and bless our great God. Thank you, Father. And they all said, amen and amen. Watch this. We're not talking about quiet church. This is noisy church. This is celebration church. This is expressive, a joy-filled, cheerful church. Verse 8, it says, then they read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. So the people are excited, they're engaged, they're leaning into it and what was being read. And then verse 9 says, then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the high the priest and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, this day is holy to the Lord your God. And what he says next is interesting, because whenever we think of the word holy, like we mentioned last weekend, we think go low, go quiet, go inside, be somber, right? But here he says just the opposite. He says, do not mourn or weep, for all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. And Nehemiah said, go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks. So the party is now getting started. It's ramping up. Amen. Here we go. It's party time. It's party time. And I'm wondering if some of the people we're like, now remind us again, Nehemiah, why are we having a party? Like we're still in debt. The things are going on. We still haven't recovered. I mean, the walls are up, but we're still dealing with the aftermath of it. You guys can be seated. We're still dealing with the aftermath. In other words, there is a virus that swept through their land. It wasn't a biological virus. It was a physical virus. Yeah. They're enemies. Right. We're continuously coming in and bombarding them. And the aftermath, like the wall got built, the vaccine came along, but they're still dealing with the repercussions. So tell us again, why are we having a party? And I love what Nehemiah says here. He says, because it's a holy day to the Lord. So do not grieve. One translation says, do not be dejected and sad, for the joy of the Lord is your strength.
Amen.
Is your strength. So enjoyment, celebration is holy to the Lord. Amen. Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 15. We read this last weekend. It says, so I recommend having fun, because there is nothing better for people in this world than to eat and drink and enjoy life. Amen. And let me just say, there is nothing better, Cross Hill Church, for a family. There's nothing better for a couple. There's nothing better for a church than to enjoy the journey, to have fun and enjoy the journey. But then he goes on, watch, and he says in verse number 15, to continue on, he says, so I recommend having fun, because there's nothing better for people in this world than eat, drink, and enjoy life. That way they will experience some happiness along with all the hard work God gives them under the sun. So watch this. If we're not careful, the most meaningful things that God has placed into our lives will become laborious and burdensome if we don't keep it fresh and keep it fun. But he's not saying that life is supposed to be a cakewalk either. There's going to be struggle. There's going to be pain. There's going to be frustration. But that doesn't mean that we don't look for ways to shine in dark places. And when I think about this in the context of God's church, especially in this season, it's easy to wake up and to think about everything that's wrong and to feel the worry and the stress and the pressure and the weight of life, and how am I able to carry this all by myself? I want to remind you today that you are never intended to carry the weight by yourself. In fact, I'll go a step further and say that the Holy Spirit spoke to us in Peter's epistle and said, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he will exalt you in due season. And I'm telling you, if there was ever a due season, this is the due season. Cast some of your care upon him, casting most of your care upon him. No, casting all of your care upon him. Why? Because he already cares for you. Amen. He's already taken the care for you. Some of you guys, you keep taking back what God has already taken. I was telling this to the Lord one day. I was like, Lord, why do I keep taking back the same care that you've already taken? And then the Lord spoke to me and said, don't pat yourself on the back too much. You haven't even cast it off the first time. And I said, what do you mean? And he said, yeah, Doug, it's not that you keep taking it back. You have never even let go of that thing. Anybody hearing me today? Am I getting through? Am I getting through to anybody? It's due season for the church to be the church and to be intentional about keeping our joy. And it's not going to happen by sitting back and wishing for joy to come back into your house. You need to be intentional about it. Come on, the harder things are around you, how many of you know the more important it is to maintain your level of joy? I read where people who laugh regularly are 40% less likely to have a heart attack than are people that don't. I don't know how strong that statistic is. I read it in a pretty reputable journal. I gave you some stats last week. Let me just repeat a little bit. Laughter boosts our immune system. It lowers blood pressure. It raises our energy levels. It reduces stress. It helps us sleep better. Stress, on the other hand, produces chemicals that attack our cells, speeding up the process of disease and decay. and aging the body prematurely. Come on, church, is it any wonder that the enemy wants us bitter and resentful and angry and stressed out all the time? Have you ever noticed how the enemy will always do his best work to try to steal your joy right before God's about to bring a breakthrough? Or right before God's about to take you to a higher level of relationship and revelation in your walk with Christ. That's when the enemy comes on the strongest to steal your joy. Just recently I've been praying and believing God about something, and I can just sense like breakthrough right on the other side of that. But each morning when I woke up, something was like just a little miss. Something was a little off, and I'd get to the office and have to deal with something right away, and I can tell it was pegging on my joy levels. And have you ever noticed, by the way, how the enemy will try to steal your joy in the morning? As you start your day, he'll cause you to be in strife with someone in your family, your wife, your husband, one of your teenagers, one of your parents, and so now you go through you start out your day strifed out and stressed out and angry and bitter, right? And even if you get over it, right, somewhere in the middle of the day, you ever notice how the enemy will always remind you just as you're going to sleep so you can lay awake and think about it all night? And so the other day, I was I knew this thing was pegging on my joy, and I knew the Lord was about to bring some breakthrough, and so I was kind of alert to it. You know, you ever know, once you know Satan's schemes, you can kind of be alert to it. You know, he hadn't thought of anything new ever. I mean, he's a poser. He doesn't create anything. He's just a poser. And so, I was fueling up my truck. I was at the gas station just the other morning, and this particular gas station is pretty big. It's got like four gas lanes, gas pump lanes. It's got a car wash attached to it. It's pretty big. And now this is pretty early in the morning, and so there might have been one other car, like on the far end, on the other side of the gas station. Like I was at one extreme. This other car was at the far end of the other side of the gas station, and I'm out there, and I don't have my mask on. I'm looking around. There's no one around. I don't have my face mask on, you know. And so there's early in the morning. There's no one near. Just the nearest person is 60 feet, 75 feet from me. I don't know. And so I'm pumping gas, and I hear this lady yell out, "Hey!" And I turned around, and she says, "You're not wearing your mask." Now let me just put a marker right there. Let me just pause right there, okay? Because I need to tell you that there was a time in my life when if someone would have got up into my space like that, like I would have come back at them. Like I would have come on them like ugly on a monkey. Like pastorally speaking, you all understand what I'm talking about. Like the louder they barked, I would have barked out even louder, and I would have said some kind of mean thing back to them to kind of chop them down. Is that still a word? I don't know. Show you how old I am. I would chop them down, right? And then I would stew about it all the way into the office, and then it would drag on. You know, I can't believe that woman's telling me put my mouth out. If she is married, I sure feel sorry for that man. All the way there, just let it stew on me, you know that? And so, yeah, you guys will be real proud of me, okay? I've learned some things, okay? And by the way, which is exactly the result that the enemy wants me to take. Right. It's not an accident. That's what his intention was to begin with. And by the way, if you think, let me just set you straight. That woman had nothing to do with my emotions. She had nothing, the strife that I would feel in that moment has nothing to do with that other person. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this world. Our warfare is not with that other person. You think you're in strife with that other person? The real enemy is the inner me. Come on, somebody, talk to me. And so, boy, I tell you what, that's exactly what the enemy would have wanted. And he wouldn't have had to done anything. Like, it would have been so easy. All he has to do is just send some lesser loser into your path and throw up just toss that thing up there, right? Throw that thing out there, little softball, and then just stand back and watch you give your power away. That you'd be real proud of me. She said, "You're not wearing your mask." And I said, in a nice way, I didn't yell back. I didn't put a scowl on my face. In fact, I actually had a smile on my face. And I said, "If you weren't so busy telling me about my mask, you would notice that your car is rolling away." And she turned around and saw her car was picking up speed. And she started after it, running after that car, and she finally caught up with the thing and got it to stop and got in there and set the brake. And then she got out and she turned around and she looked at me. And you guys would be real proud of me, because there was a day when I wanted to say, "Listen, I would have helped you, but you know, the whole social distancing thing and all." But I didn't. I just said, "You all right?" And she said, "Yeah." And I said, "That's good." Like that. And I got in my truck, and as I left, I waved at her, and she smiled and waved at me, right? And now I'm going to the office. Instead of being all bitter and stressed out and frustrated, now I'm smiling and laughing and a good one. That was a good one. Like, you know what I'm saying? All right. Praise God. Did I ever tell you guys about the time when I had a fit of carnality at the Rite Aid? Have I ever told you guys about that? A total fit of carnality. I had to get saved all over again at the Rite Aid one day. We were in there. I was getting something. It doesn't matter what it was, but I walked up to the checkout, and there was it was kind of late at night, and there was no checkout open. There was no registers open, and there was a sign that said "Register open at the photo booth center." Okay, apparently they have a photo development thing. So I walked back to the photo development area, and there was a person there getting help, and so I waited in line with my stuff, and a couple more people came up behind me, and that person got done, and I stepped up to the counter, and let me just describe the young man who was at the counter, okay? He was tatted up like you can see it, arms, neck, face, I don't have anything. Trust me, I don't have anything against tattoos. You want a tattoo, go for it. I think some of them look kind of cool. I just wouldn't put it on myself, just the same way you wouldn't put a bumper sticker on a Ferrari. But I'm just saying, you know. But so anyway, he was all tatted up, you know, and then he had, check this out, he had a bone going through his nose. Now, I'm not even joking. I'm telling you the truth. He had, I don't know how he got it in there. I don't know if a friend helped him put the bone in his nose. I don't know if he ate the chicken that was on the bone before it went in his nose. I have no idea. I don't know, but there was a bone going through his nose like that. And so after I kind of took all this in, it was my turn to walk up to the counter, and I laid my stuff up on the counter, and he says, he looked past me, and he says, "Is there anyone here dropping off any pictures?" And there was a lady behind me. She said, "Yeah, I am. I'm dropping off some pictures." He said, "Well, come on up. Come on up. You can drop off your pictures." So she went on up there, and he rang her up. I stepped back, you know, like this. And I'm thinking, that's kind of weird. You know, I was in line. So he helped her out. And then I walked up, and I put my stuff on the counter. And he says, is there anyone else who's dropping off pictures and doing picture stuff?" And there was a guy who said, yeah, I am. And he said, "Well, come on up. You can do that." And I said to him, I said, "Excuse me, I'm here. I just need to pay for this and I'll leave." And he says, "Well, yeah, I'll get to you, but this is the photo development center." And to which I said, I get that. But your registers up front are closed, and the sign says to come back here. So as far as I'm concerned, this stops being the photo development center, and this is now the main checkout center. To which he replied, "Do you see the sign that says photo development? The Apostle Paul said it like this. He says, I have to die to the flesh daily. He says, because there are times when listen, if I don't let that flesh man die and keep him dead, that guy that was crucified with Christ, it's like I'm dragging him around in a coffin. And every once in a while, he wants to get out. And he starts saying, let me out. Let me out. And when that guy said to me, do you see the sign? Sweet Jesus. I had a fit of carnality. I had a moment. The rage, I'm not kidding you, it just came on top of me, and I did not look like a pastor. It was horrible. I wanted to reach across the counter and grab him by the bone and jerk his head down on the counter a few times and say, ring me up, like that. But I didn't. I left. And I'm telling you, all the way home, I had this terrible feeling in my gut, right? Have you ever said something to someone that the moment you said it, you thought, I'd like to get that back? Now, I wish I could tell you guys that old carnal, fleshly guy that felt like grabbing that kid by the bone and violently jerking his head on the counter has never resurfaced in my life. But that would be a lie. But I can tell you that I have had opportunities to apply the truths that I'm teaching you guys here today. And in those moments where you say something and you think, I wish I could get that back. I wish I wouldn't have said that. The psalmist said it like this in Psalm 141, verse 3. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Have you ever prayed and asked God to set up a security guard over your mouth so that you wouldn't say some of the stupid things that you've said in your life? Like, you ever just prayed, God, like that one lady, she went to her pastor and she said, Pastor, I gotta get my tongue on the altar. And he said, Dear Lord in heaven, woman, there's not an altar in this church big enough. Now, I'm just saying today, have you ever had a moment, like an unguarded moment, where someone does something and all of a sudden you have a whoopsie moment?
Yes.
Huh? Someone cuts you off on the freeway. Whoopsie. You're in a parking lot and you're getting ready to pull in somewhere and you see an open spot and all of a sudden, just before you get there, someone decides to drive the wrong way down that aisle and hurry up and beat you. Whoopsie! Now let me ask you a question. What's the first thought that comes to your mind? Bless is hard. Come on in there, sugar. You can have that. Praise the Lord. I was just hoping, just wishing that you would come down that aisle and get that space. That's the reason I didn't speed up there. I'm just so thankful that you can. I'll just circle around again a few more. No other words start forming in your mouth. How many know what I'm talking about? Mama say, mama sa, mama kusa. Mama say, mama sa, mama kusa. Okay, any other words? Listen, I want to give you three things that you can do right now that's going to help you to enjoy the journey. These are three things that you guys need to do. Number one, generosity on your face. Generosity on your face. If I'm not careful, and I'm talking about me, when I come home, it's easy for me to have a tendency to put on deadpan face and to be expressionless. And my wife knows what I'm talking about. She's seen it, and just to be emotionless and expressionless, and just kind of deadpan face and go inward. And it's not because I'm sad, and it's not because I'm unhappy, and it's not because I'm angry about something. A lot of times it's because I've already spent 10 hours worth of smiles at the office. And so by the time I come home, I've left all my smiles that I've used up for the day back at the office, and now I don't have any for her. And I'm just telling you this. Listen, guys, there's in this teaching, I'm talking to you, part of this teaching is basically saying, let's be cognizant about not giving each other the worst. Let's be mindful about giving each other our best. It's amazing how we could just be like deadpan face, walk around emotionless, joyless, around the people who are closest to us, right? But the moment a stranger walks up who hasn't invested anything into our lives, all of a sudden we're like, hi! Well, praise the Lord. So good to have you. It's so good to see you today. And listen, I'm just telling you today, if we're not careful, we'll give strangers a better part than we give our own family in our own family church. Number two, levity in your heart. Levity comes from the Latin word lightness. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1, and from the Message translation, it says, one final word, friends. We ask you, urge you is more like it, that you keep on doing what we told you to do to please God. Listen, not in a dogged religious plod, but in a living, spirited dance. I'm not saying, guys, that we have to walk around with phony clown face and put our feelings into the sand and pretend like nothing's wrong. I'm saying that can we just get better at raising our own awareness that we are God's people? And no matter what goes on around here, the joy of the Lord is still king in here.
Amen.
Amen. We've been called by God, Cross Hill Church, to be a house where when people walk in, joy fills the atmosphere.
Amen.
And not in a dogged religious plod that sucks the life out of the room. One of the sure signs of a plodding church is when church people start seeing church as a burden, and low commitment takes the place of passionate, spirit-filled service for the Lord. I'm just saying today, if I was to close out this message, I'm just saying that I know that there's things that are going on around us that are tough in this season, and I know that everything isn't right, and I know that there's some struggles that are going on. But can we just agree as God's people to lighten up?
Amen.
Can we just agree? In fact, turn to someone who's sitting near you today right now and say, lighten up.
Lighten up.
Like, can we just agree as faith-filled God's people to lighten up a little bit? Come on, can I tell you that no matter what's taking place around us in this season today, God already has a grace for every obstacle that we are facing. He already has a grace for every challenge that we're going through. And if you don't learn to be intentional about adding levity, you'll stay rigid and frustrated and joyless and bitter. Why isn't that working? Why is this taking so long? Why did they say that? I've watched people walk into church. By the time they get through the front doors, they're already in a bad attitude. And you walk by them and you can feel it coming off of them. Right? You just feel that negativity and that bad attitude coming off of them, can I just remind us today, generosity on your face and levity in your heart, and number three, praise in your mouth. Does anyone listening want to have more fun on the journey? Come on, does anyone, is there any families out there who want to enjoy the journey more than you are right now? Praise is different than worship. Praise is a joyful noise. It's a joyful noise. Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with singing. Know you that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with, come on, into his courts with, be thankful and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Amen. I'm saying, let's get some praise on our mouths. Praise is celebration. Not to get technical, but praise is about God, while worship is to God. Have you ever had someone like brag on you in front of someone else and you can hear them? Like maybe they didn't even know they were doing it, but you can hear them and they were talking about how good you were and what you did, and maybe the talent that you had, or boy, didn't they do great, and boy, they're so awesome at that. And how did that make you feel? It's pretty good, isn't it? You know, God is the same way. Do you know our Heavenly Father, he loves it when we talk and we sing to him. But can I tell you guys, there is something that moves the heart of God when faith-filled, joy-filled people gather together and start singing and talking and celebrating about our good God. On a balmy day in October in 1982, Badger Stadium in Wisconsin, Illinois, Madison, Wisconsin, was filled to overflowing capacity, like 60,000 screaming fans. The Badgers were hosting Michigan State University. And there were high hopes for the Badgers that day. But it wasn't too far into the game that the Badger fans began to realize that their team was outmatched by a better team. And by the time the second half showed up, they were being beaten so badly, the score was so lopsided. But here's something interesting that began to happen. The Badger fans, rather than going inward and going quiet, they got into a celebratory attitude and atmosphere. 60,000 screaming fans began to stand up and cheer and shout and jump up and down. They were high-fiving each other. And as it turned out, 70 miles away, the Milwaukee Brewers were beating the St. Louis Cardinals in Game 3 of the 1982 World Series. And a lot of the fans had portable radios with them. And they were responding to something other than what they were watching on the field. But the interesting thing is that the Badger players didn't know that the praise wasn't for them. And something began to shift inside of them. And they turned their play game around. And they started marching back and scoring and fighting the clock and clawing back. And by the end of the game, what should have been a laughing blowout was a nail biter. Why? Because praise is contagious. Cheer is contagious. Joy is contagious. And can I say, Cross Hill, joy is God's idea. It's God's plan. It's powerful. It's healing. It's spiritual. And what we read today is also holy. And when you get bumped down and burdened down and under pressure and the enemy pounces on you, the first thing to go is your joy. But if you want to get it back, I'm telling you, the first thing you need to do is get back your joy. Because joy will move things. It'll change the atmosphere. And in this season of uncertainty, I'm saying that we have the opportunity to be a church of true, genuine joy. People who will rise up and celebrate, not because of what's going on around them, but because what's in us, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Can I get a witness today? Oh, come on, let's go patty cake. If the joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen. And amen. God bless you. Listen, if you're here and you're watching and maybe you tuned in, maybe someone invited you to log in and you've been watching this service today and something has been piercing your heart because you don't have that joy. You've never experienced it. You've experienced moments of happiness. But happiness is not joy. Happiness is a byproduct of your condition. It's a byproduct of your circumstances. Can I tell you something? Joy comes from the truth that you know. When you see a believer who's filled with joy and who isn't stressed out, who's turned that care over, and you're like, how do they, I want what they have. It's because they're celebrating the truth that they know. What they know is that Jesus said, in this world, there's going to be tribulation. Tribulation. But be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. And maybe you're watching and you don't have that confidence because you don't have a relationship. You've never made Jesus the Lord of your life. I want to invite you today to simply pray a prayer and ask Him to come into your heart and make Him your Lord and your Savior. And we're not asking you to fill out a membership card. We're not asking you to join a church. We're not asking you to go to a seminar. We're not even asking you to read all this book before you're worthy to know Him. We're just asking you to trust that if he's put that in your heart, that's the Spirit of God convicting you. He's rattling your heart cage. He's talking to you right now. It's not an accident that you're watching. So just do that today. Make the greatest decision you'll ever make. Just say this with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I am a sinner and I need a Savior. I want to experience that genuine joy that I heard the pastor talk about today. And so I ask that you forgive me of all my sin. Cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I surrender my life to you. And by faith, I believe in you. I believe you died on the cross. I believe you were raised from the dead. And I surrender my heart to you, my life to you. In Jesus' name, I make you my Lord and my Savior. Amen and amen. Listen, if you prayed that simple prayer, listen, we believe you got born again today. Angels in heaven are rejoicing and singing right now because you made the greatest decision of your life. Your journey starts today. Right now is the first day of the best of your life. And we want to be a part of that with you. We want to send something to you. We want to pray with you. We have someone who can talk to you. just go on crosshillchurch.com. You can call us, you can log in, you can write us, let us know that you received Jesus as your Savior and Lord. But anyway, God bless you guys. Thank you for being a part of this Memorial Weekend celebration. Enjoy one another, enjoy your family. We're going to see each other back really soon. I'm telling you, listen for those updates. It might happen this week, actually. God bless you guys in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you.